few days ago, we heard him, that's my view, struggling to defend the large elephant size of government. And his intimation to the Ghanaian public was that we did not campaign on this promise. I'm minded that as a communicator, values are timeless. And the value to run a lean government, if we referred you to the campaign promises of the new patriotic party that you have so actively worked for, going back to 2008 and to the political promise of that generation. But circumspection, in terms of what you share with the public, will it guide your communication strategy as you walk from that partisan communicator to a national communicator, and that every comment you make is of national and international interest and would be interrogated? And therefore, if you appear to be assisting the minister and the president, and you appear to create an impression of being impervious to public opinion, you may be contributing to the peril of the system you belong to. Can you comment on this and what you think? So that if you don't look your minister eye now and talk, you can do the other one when you get back to the ministries.
I think it's rather a long one, but I'll attempt to answer it. I believe that in the wisdom of the president, Nana Addo Dankwa Akufo-Addo, we are in special times as a nation. After 60 years of independence, for the Ghanaian people to have given him such an overwhelming mandate, it is imperious that he assembles a solid team to help him propel this country into creating the equal opportunity that he envisages for our people. And that is why I believe he has put together these numbers to help him govern this country. On the front that we have metamorphosed from party communicators to become government communicators, yes, it is something that will continue to be at the back of our minds as we communicate with the Ghanaian people, knowing very well that we're working in a national interest and not in a partisan interest. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Ghana today is comparable even to the United States in terms of expanding the parameters of freedom of speech and freedom of expression, and the number of radio FM stations, the number of newspaper publications. Do you think that we need to further regulate any aspect of the media in Ghana?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I believe every right comes with some level of responsibility. And therefore, the continuous spread of our freedoms in terms of our press freedoms and the continued expansion of our media space, I believe, needs some level of regulation. And I know that there are a few bills that have been in and out of the August House. I know that my minister would spearhead the effort to make sure that the regulatory regimes are passed in order for us to have some sanity within the media space. Thank you.
There is still no broadcast law. There has been effort and attempts, and in particular, I'm mindful of the support you should be assisting your minister to redefine and resituate GBC as a national broadcaster comparable to BBC or the Deutsche Welle as you have it. Will you support your minister in that enterprise? I'm more responsive to satisfying the information needs of the Ghanaian people.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I will pledge to support my honorable minister in that regard. I will pledge to support because there are several agencies under the Ministry of Information. A lot of these agencies have very peculiar problems, and it is something that he's taken upon himself in familiarizing himself and going to the doorsteps of these agencies to get at first hand the state of these agencies and then fashion out a strategy to drive them out of their current situation. And GBC is one of them. When I get to the ministry, with your nod, I would assist the minister in making sure that flagship agencies like GBC that have wide nationwide coverage for TV and radio are helped to become the CNNs of Africa. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Chair is here to support the nominee, the GNA, the Ghana News Agency. Given your enterprising role in the media landscape generally, what will you be doing with your minister to assist the GNA deliver on its core mandate, Ghana News Agency?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. GNA is one of the agencies under the ministry that, like I said before, needs some restructuring and refocus. In today's digital age, it is difficult for agencies like GNA to survive if their mandate is not tweaked and repackaged to serve the needs of growing developmental and as well as the digital age that we work in today. GNA mainly has been a news agency gathering news from around the country, mainly on developmental issues, bordering on development communications. But in today's competitive media space, GNA needs to go beyond just gathering information on development in order to be able to survive. And therefore, I would assist my minister in making sure that we brainstorm to fashion out a way to redirect the role of GNA in our media space. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Last, and the rest will be a comment as I wish the nominee well, is to note that your ministry is to collaborate with the Ministry of Communication on a major digital activity taking place of the transition of Ghana from analog to digital television, which will affect radio and will affect matters of content and improving the quality. And I believe that that will even help GBC going on. But Chairman, noting that the nominee's right to speak ends at my right not to listen, I still have a firm belief that there are excesses within the operations of the Ghanaian media landscape. And laws that protect reputation are sometimes resorted to because the National Media Commission has its own independent role to play in regulating it. But if you just get up in the morning and they say, why? I want to ask you this, even as you don't know the matter, you are forced. So a certain culture is emerging where cross-checking. So it's for you, even as government officials, when you hear something about parliament, you hear something about a government ministry and department, it's important that you cross-check your facts. Because in Ghana, what I've noticed is retracting and saying, I'm sorry, sometimes many of us find it difficult to do, even though it's the most honorable thing to do. So my comment is that Ho and then Mbole coming to other parts of the country, it appears that over the years they have difficulty assessing quality access to television. And I think that is a matter that you must assist your minister. You, your temperament, I don't know. As for your minister, he knows that I know his temperament very, very well. So I wish the two of you very well. God bless.
My first question, how will you work with your minister to strengthen the duties of public relations officers as we have them in the ministries, departments, and agencies across the country, given that I have heard, and you will confirm if that is the case, that you will be supporting them with other people. You'll be appointing other people in those agencies and ministries to support in communication, because some communication is political. So how will you generally be strengthening the public relations officers at our various ministries, departments, and agencies to carry out their activities?
I am aware that my minister has begun taking some steps to make sure that the public relations officers who work in the various ministries get some capacity building. He's met them a couple of times already in trying to ascertain the difficulties that they have working in the sort of environments they work in, and also to find solutions to the problems that they have. The public relations officers in the various ministries are posted from an agency under the ministry, which is the Information Service Department. So they are under the direct control of the Ministry of Information, and therefore, being a public relations practitioner myself, I will assist in making sure that they do a good job, since doing a good job ensures the benefit of communicating government policy to the people of Ghana. Thank you.
So, Honorable Ablakwa has questions. Since he is recruiting himself. Sometime last year.
Today, Chairman says, it's you people, your radio information people. So you can see Ablakwa.
Then you are missing out. Right.
The propaganda outfit of politics is your day. I leave it to you.
Sometime last year, the NPP headquarters was a very busy place, especially for a Ghana Police Service. They came there a number of times, and in one instance, they were told some people broke in to their offices and they got arrested. You were of the view, and strongly so, that the people who came there were NDC assigns, and you were convinced they were sent by President Mahama, because, in your words, he was a desperate candidate. What evidence did you adduce to that?
I don't remember making such comments.
So I take it that it was propaganda, negative propaganda. You were also at some point around that same time accused by people closely associated with your former chairman as the one being behind some stories. Because, as it was revealed, the party actually had a communication unit within the office, and you were in charge of it, especially the Facebook hawks. And many of the people who were not pleasantly treated by your communicators thought that you were the commander and chief of that. And you churned out, according to them, your party members, false information just to tarnish their image. What assurance do we have as a nation that we will not be subject of this vilification that your party members accuse you of when you run the communications directorate at the party office?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. First of all, I'll take the opportunity to clear the air on this matter. There's never been any instance where I have superintended over any group of people to churn out any information whatsoever about a fellow party member, not even to talk about an opponent. So it is not true that I organized a group of people to churn out false information about any single individual in my party. It is not true. It is a figment of the imagination of whoever put out a tape, and I will explain. A tape was put out on a particular radio station. It was a conversation between myself and our suspended chairman. It was a conversation that I didn't even know was being recorded. I entered the office one afternoon and there was an argument. So I asked the people who were arguing what it was about. And it was about a post, an individual, not a worker in my office. An individual had posted something on social media that the former chairman had problems with. As a responsible person, I asked the gentleman to show me what he had posted. After he had shown it to me, I asked him to retract if he had no evidence. He said he had no evidence. He retracted. I asked that the chairman be called, and it was the conversation that I had with the chairman in getting the guy to apologize to the chairman that was recorded and put on radio that I had engineered that whole incident. I was rather trying to let peace prevail. I was not the one who engineered that incident. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Maybe related to that also is when Dr. Wereku Brobe was summoned to meet the committee, a disciplinary committee. Later, he accused you by name of masterminding an attack on his person. That's your party man. In fact, he's one of your founding members. Could he be wrong that you have that character in you to organize tags, to attack responsible citizens?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. It is not in my character, and I'm not a violent person. I know Honorable Suhini himself knows me personally. I'm not a violent person. I believe that out of the blue, the member of my party maybe saw me at the party head office. I think at that time I was the most senior person at the party office at the time. And when there was that misunderstanding, I intervened to make sure that things did not get out of hand.
When the police arrested some South Africans who were said to have been brought into this country by your party to train some people, you appeared on the PM show on Joy News Channel, and you described what the police put out as exaggerated facts. Facts are either facts or they are not. So I would like you to explain what you meant by exaggerated facts.
I don't, once again, I don't remember saying that they were exaggerated facts. I believe on our side at the time, we disagreed with how the suspects at the time were tagged. And the sorts of things that were said about them, we thought were not true. And I believe maybe that is why I use the word exaggerated facts, if indeed I did. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Chairman, thank you. I'm all right.
Yes, Taliban. Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, and congratulations to Curtis Perry Kwabla Okudzeto. The last time your minister appeared before this committee, he gave assurances that he was going to work
assiduously to help sanitize the Ghanaian media landscape, and also to improve standards. I want to know if you are aware of the status of the media fund that was created, and whether or not you are going to advocate for more support for the fund to improve the capacity of media personnel in Ghana.
The media fund, as of now, I know has been exhausted. It is for us as a ministry to advocate and then convince the funding authority to put some money into the fund. However, I am aware that my minister has made some moves in order to build the capacity of personnel in various media houses. I am aware that he has had some discussion with professional bodies, for example, the Institute of Public Relations Ghana, in order to, in the future, organize capacity building workshops for media personnel across the landscape. I believe that if we get access to the funding, I would support my minister in making sure that a chunk of the media fund is dedicated towards the capacity building of media personnel in our country in order to sanitize the output of the various people within the media. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Congratulations, Honorable Minister Nominee, Deputy Minister Nominee. Could you assure this committee and Ghanaians how you would help your minister to disseminate accurate information of government to Ghanaians such that you will not say a goat is an elephant?
The Ministry of Information serves a basic role of being the hub that manages government communications and managing policy dissemination across the country. And that is why it has an agency, once again, like the Information Service Department, and also other media networks that are supposed to churn out information. The Information Service Department has information officers in about 181 out of the 216 to do or to execute their duties effectively and to make sure that the districts that do not have information officers are given information officers to aid the district assemblies in those districts to disseminate the activities of those district assemblies. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
And then my last question is, by the end of your tenure, how would you anticipate the reportage of the media, Ghanaian media, in the next 4 years?
I believe that there are bills that will come before Parliament regarding our sector. And these are very important bills that will help shape the output of the Ghanaian media. If we also go on the tangent of implementing the vision of the ministry as well as the vision of the minister and the government, where we engage in capacity building for our media personnel, make sure that we deliver the right information at the right time, especially in today's digital age where the news cycle has changed into seconds and minutes because people have access to social media and are able to express their opinion from wherever they are on their gadgets. The news cycle is no more newspaper headlines every morning. So in managing this, we need to make sure that as a ministry, we are on top of this churning out accurate information at appropriate time to make sure that the public is well briefed. And I'm sure that in making sure that we build a capacity of those who are carrying the information, we would sanitize our media space. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
An article which was written as a rejoinder to a columnist who wrote in the Spectator newspaper that your ministry should not exist, should have been abandoned several years ago. Have you come across the rejoinder? And what will you say about that rejoinder in relation to the columnist advocacy for abolition of your ministry?
I believe that, like I said before, editors of newspapers and editors of the various media houses need to be circumspect in where they pick information from in today's world. Working for the party's communications directorate over the years, I've had several instances where people have issued statements in my name and written my name underneath as if it was coming from me. In today's age, these things are done by unscrupulous people who mean harm. And I would encourage that our editorial rules are stringent. Editors should make sure they are sure of the source of information before they are published. And I believe that newspapers like The Spectator that have been around for quite a while, it's a media house that I have worked in for a number of years where I cut my teeth as a journalist. I believe it was an oversight, and it's an issue that has been taken up at the highest level in the ministry. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Journalism and the kind of things that happen with journalists is the fact that their conditions of service are not good at all. Indeed, many of them struggle to even get transport fares to go and cover events. You have also practiced as a journalist. What will you do to motivate journalists to be appreciated in terms of their compensation and other things?
Chair, I think that the practice of journalism itself has to be looked at and regulated properly in our country. There are various professions in this world, and to be able to qualify to become someone who's a professional in any field, you may need some basic training. But it is the practice that in Ghana, everybody who is able to write or read can become a journalist. And it is the bane of the problem that is affecting our standards, and also a part of the reason why remuneration for journalists has not been something that has been looked at, because people are free to employ just anyone to become a reporter. If we're able to regulate properly and make sure that we build the capacities of our journalists, once you are recruited through a certain process and your credentials are clear, I'm sure that there will be levels within such organizations where remuneration will be pegged so that people don't just walk into media houses and are employed and then anything is paid to them because they do not have the requisite qualification. It is something that I have been through myself as a young journalist, stringing for a newspaper and not getting paid for several years. And in those days, you had to just gain the experience. So you had to do it. So you had to find a way of getting paid in order to be able to get the experience. So coming from that background, I will take it upon myself to make sure that I assist my minister and the ministry to be able to sanitize at least the practice of journalism and public relations in our country, so that people who are professionals, who are trained to be journalists and public relations practitioners, are given the right pay to be able to feed their families. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Can you give me any reason when the new executive took office and they decided to dispense of your service?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Yes, I was.
So what was the reason given?
I was asked to proceed on leave.
So if you're at the party headquarters, do people proceed on the leave? For how long have you been engaged there that and you were not taking your leave? Once you were there, I can see that you've been there for some time, and you were not taking your leave.
Well, my understanding of the corporate governance structure and the kind of organization that I work in is that you are not given compulsory leave. If you needed leave, you applied for it. And it has been the practice in that organization since I started work in it until that incident.
I don't know whether you are conversant with the New Labour Act with regards to leave.
But the type of employment in a political party setting is not a full-time, though in actual sense, we work sometimes for 24 hours. You are a volunteer, and therefore you do not qualify under the circumstances to be given compulsory leave.
In fact, that was what I thought. So when you were talking about the leave, and you went ahead to say in the corporate environment, and I said, hey, so MPP head office is now run like a corporate office. Anyway, that was the teaser. Now, I mean, there's this belief that your outfit has overlived its usefulness. That's the Minister of Information, for the simple reason that looking at the technology that is used today, the method of dissemination, the private sector, how it has developed in terms of the media landscape, sometimes information before the government people who adhere to the rules of verification, ensuring that the checks are done, authentication, the news will have gone past like 72 hours. So it's like by the time you do all this processing, the news is gone. And therefore, why will your ministry even be created in the first place? How do you respond to those critics?
I believe that in today's world, the Ministry of Information is even more critical than ever before. Why do I say that? I say that because in today's digital age, you need professional managers of information to be able to galvanize and put together strategies that can churn out information in a systematic way. If you don't do that, I believe any government will crash. Because today, the people out there have a voice. You do not only read stories in newspapers anymore. You do not wait for the 6 a.m. news or the midday news or news at 6 p.m. or wait to get home to watch 7 p.m. news on GTV. The news is driven right by people holding mobile phones. And like someone said, image is everything. You need a professional manager of information who makes sure that the people are always informed. We have seen uprisings across Africa just because of the use of social media. It tells you that if you do not manage information properly, nations can, today you do not need to go carry a gun to be able to do a coup d'etat. Social media has become that powerful. So it is important that in today's world, we have managers of information that feed the people with accurate information at all times in order to have some sanity prevail within our society. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Mr. Chairman, be that when you go to the presidency, if not all, most of the private, whether television or radio stations, have correspondence from the office of the president. And sometimes, even whilst the information is being processed for release, they help people within them, they just tell them, oh, this is coming out, so can you let me just see it? I will wait till you release it. And before you say, Jack, they are even ahead of you. Before you start announcing it, it's already out there. And this one is, someone will say, at no cost to the state, because they are sending their correspondents there. They are there every day to listen to what is happening around. Do you still believe that the ministry, despite all these private players around, say, the presidency, you still need the Minister of Information to be disseminating information that will be really thrown out there or disseminated by private practitioners?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. That the role of the Information Ministry is crucial. The presidency and the press corps at the presidency report activities that take place in the presidency. There are over 30 other ministries here in Accra. There are 210 districts across the country. There are 10 regions in this country. Information management goes beyond the Flagstaff House. And even though the seat of government is where decisions are taken, other decisions that affect the governance of this country are also taken in various departments around the country. And therefore, you need a central point where these things are managed from. Under the dispensation we have now, even the Flagstaff House Communications Bureau is a subset or a part of the Ministry of Information. So the Ministry of Information manages both the Flagstaff House communications as well as information dissemination from all agencies of government.
Even though you are not yet there, having operated in the media landscape, you are aware that whether the MMDAs, the 216 districts that you are talking about, many government agencies, they rely more on the private media houses. And sometimes they even forget that Ghana News Agency is there, or even their own information service person is there. They just call the private broadcasters to help them disseminate information. What are you going to do differently in assisting your minister to ensure that they take their right place, where they will be the first to turn out and therefore sure of sanitizing and giving the right information? Because I mean, my minister, as government minister, the only thing that I can remember very well, that maybe when we are commissioner president, they'll come and mount the van and then provide public address system for us to address the people. But in terms of disseminating what is happening in the constituency, you virtually rely on private broadcasters to do that. What will you do to assist the minister to position them well to do the work that they are supposed to do?
Information dissemination. There's a backroom part, which is processing the information, packaging the information before it is given to agencies to be able to push. the medium, which is the plural medium that we have, allows for private sector, the private sector to participate in the media space. And that is why we have seen over 300 radio stations spring up across the country, newspapers, TV stations across the country. These private media houses are not bound by law to do development communications, for instance. They are commercial radio stations and commercial media houses, if I may put it that way. And therefore, there are things that are very pivotal to the administration of this country that is not in the interest of a commercial media house to churn out. And that is why you need, in a democracy like ours, a balance where state owns a certain part of media, and then there is private media for everybody to compete in the space. You also need strategists and professional media managers to guide the process. And that is why in a ministry like the Ministry of Information, we have agencies like GBC, we have agencies like the Information Service Department, we have the Ghana News Agency, there's the Ghana Publishing Company, and other companies that sort of have been divested. They play a role of development communications. That is why earlier on I said that in rebranding an agency like the Ghana News Agency, we need to do it in a way to make them more competitive by making sure that they not do only development communications, but also bring in and join the new trends in our media landscape so that they can also be able to survive. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Yes, he engages in adult education in several languages. This is something you will not get on private TV.
I didn't hear that.
I said GBC has programs in different dialects, I think about 8 dialects, that is believed to be spoken across the length and breadth of Ghana. And they bring in guests to come and explain things bordering on development, you know, of our nation to the rest of the population. This is something, for example, that is not done by private media.
Isn't that it will not be done much, or it's not done at all? Because I know also some of
it is not done at all, because private media is commercial. And for private media houses, programs like this, which is segmented to only a particular segment of society, is not lucrative for them, and therefore they will not do it. And that is why we still need a bit of state ownership of media to an extent to be able to keep the citizenry informed on what government is doing. Thank you.
So when multimedia, maybe through Joy News, do a documentary about Galamsey, or when Joy News does documentary about the prisons, overcrowding the prisons, they do documentary about even maternal issues. Are these not developmental issues? Because you say that they don't do at all.
Yes, these are developmental issues. But I'm saying that, for instance, breaking them down, for adult education.
You just agree that they do some, but maybe the state-owned does more.
Yes.
And focus more.
Yes, I agree.
Mr. Chairman, in an earlier question that he answered, he said that if we build the capacity of most of the media persons that we have, we may get to sanitize the airwaves. Is that right? Did I hear him say that in an answer to an earlier question?
Yes, I did.
Well, you agree with me that most of our radio stations and television stations have been procured and set up for a purpose. And so most of the time it's for an interest. And I know very well, I doubt whether when you were in opposition, you were wasting your time listening to GTV and Ghana News, Ghana Radio Ghana. You rather want to listen to those that will excite you, that will push some of the things that you want to hear and tell the people. So there's an agenda setting. You think that there will be an amount of training that will get such radio stations and television stations to change, because the owners set them up for a purpose.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I think that it is a duty for all stakeholders within our society to take up. And it is a duty also for the Ministry of Information, being the central point in managing information in this country, to also take up.
Mr. Chairman, and do you agree with me that, for example, in Parliament, when you become a member of Parliament and you want to carry on with your business, you have to apply through a committee we have in Parliament here for them to verify and then give you a certificate that, oh, yes, you are a member of Parliament. By constitution, you're not supposed to work, but because of these reasons, we've given you a certificate that Parliament is aware of your business. That business is not going to interfere with your work, and therefore you can carry on to manage it. Would you want to agree with me that every owner, everybody who wants to own a radio station and television station, should be profiled so that we all know who owns what? And it's known to all of us, because there will be a database that with my phone I can Google and know that, oh, after this Okudzeto FM is for Honorable Ablakwa. And therefore, we'll all be able to guide ourselves to know that if their program content is heading towards a direction, it may help all of us to be able to say that it is because of this reason that this is happening. Will you support that?
I agree perfectly that should be done.
Mr. Chairman, lastly, in your answer to an earlier question, you said that, oh, let's try and peg the remuneration of workers within the media landscape. Did I hear that?
My assertion was that every profession everywhere in the world has some form of structure and is regulated. And that is why when you are employed, based on the basic qualification you have in that profession, you are paid a certain amount of money. We don't see a lot of that within the media space in Ghana. And I was advocating that if we help to take stock of those who are practicing now, and build their capacity so that the threshold would be based on your ability, and then you are paid according to what contributions you make to the media organization, as well as making sure that we sanitize the system where people who are trained for a particular profession are the ones who are able to be employed in that area and are paid according to industry standards.
Well, you... No, I'm just following up, because if you take the, say, hotel industry, the workers there, is the demand and supply that determines how much people pay, apart from the minimum wage. And that is here. In the telecommunication, is the demand and supply that determines how much you are paid. If you go to Makwala and you choose to be a security person, it's a demand and supply that will determine how much you are paid. Why do you think that we should standardize the salaries and remuneration of people in the media landscape?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. It is because the industry is a peculiar one. I don't believe that when you go to a hospital, you will allow a nurse to do the job of a doctor. And that is why in the media landscape, you need people who understand the industry, to work in the industry and to pay them according to their qualifications. If we do not do that, and we think that media engagements are things that anybody could do, we will get to a point in our democracy where it will be dangerous for us to even listen to radio, because the people who will be churning out whatever information, like you said or you alluded to earlier, media owners are not profiled. And radio stations, if you are right, may be set up to do particular things within our public sphere. And therefore, if we do not from now on begin to regulate and make sure that the people who are handling our airwaves are qualified and will go according to the ethics of the professions within that industry, there may be chaos. And that is why it is important that we do this. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Chairman, I can see my colleagues still have a lot of energy. Should we continue? Oh, I thought you were going to... Your minister is looking at me and staring at me. Ah, congratulate you. I wish you
all. Thank you. Thank you for what you have done for the day. Thank you. Okay. Are there any acknowledgements?